Hey, good morning, friends. Hey, Brother Mike, back on Sunday morning, 9 a.m. podcast. And thank you for tuning in again. I need to share some things from the Holy Ghost with you today. They're very important. You can reach me if you need to. Send me an email at mike@hardcorechristianity.com. The website, of course, is hardcorechristianity.com. I wanted you to remember some of our services. Every Wednesday night at 6 p.m. Mountain Time, we have a live healing and deliverance podcast. You send me an email, mike@hardcorechristianity.com. I'll send you the ID code and the password. It's a powerful service. A lot of people are on the Zoom, and it's an amazing period of anointing. You'll love it. Also, we have two live services every week at the Arizona Deliverance Center. We're downtown on 15th Avenue, just south of Osborn Road. And that starts at 7 p.m. Mountain Time. Both services are broadcast live on our YouTube channel, plus several other platforms, youtube.com/houseofhealingaz. If you need a donation receipt for 2022, please send me an email, mike@hardcorechristianity.com, and I will send it out instamatically. We had another record year of giving, and I thank you so much for all that you did for us. It was remarkable. We paid all of our bills on time or early. No problemo. Thanks to you. And may God richly bless you. You can download our Tithely app, or you can donate on the website. As I've mentioned several times before, I do not take a salary in the ministry. Neither does my wife, and neither does anyone on the ministry team. We all work as volunteers for the kingdom of God. Thank you for your support. It has been fantastic. If you happen to live in Maricopa County, I've been on the radio, local radio here, for 20 years. February will be my 21st year. I'm on KXXT 1010 AM, and the radio schedule is on the homepage of the website. My main broadcast is every morning at 7:30, Monday through Friday. Plus, I'm on in the evenings on the radio, and I'm also on Saturdays and Sundays. May God richly bless you. Okay, here we go. Turn with me, if you will, to Mark chapter 1, verse 40. Here, the Holy Spirit has written some spectacular material. It's really quite hard to believe. It couldn't get any better than this. It's absolutely fantastic. And it says here, there came a leper to Jesus, beseeching him and kneeling down to him. And he said to him, "If you will, you can make me clean." Now, let's break that verse down just for a second. Beseeching is the Greek word paralikeo. It means to ask someone to come stand by your side and be there to support you and help you. He was begging for God to come to him and be with him and to help him. And why would he say that? Well, as you know, he was a leper, and the Greek word is lepros, and it means to have scales. He was dying of leprosy, and as you know, lepers were outcasts in Israeli societies. Kind of like you were an outcast during this phony pandemic, where they were quarantining everybody in 2020, destroying the country and wrecking our economy and ruining the lives of our school children. They did it deliberately. That's a different Bible study. And here you see an outcast. This guy did not live with his family or his friends or in normal society. When you got leprosy, obviously it's a communicable disease, he was ostracized. And here he comes begging God to come alongside him, paralikeo, come stand by me. And here you see him kneeling down And the reason he knelt down was because he was worshiping him. And in this particular verse, we see the Holy Spirit showing us that Jesus received worship. Okay. Now let me give you a little tip about worship. I have never been worshiped or received worship because I am not worthy to be worshiped. Okay. I'm just a regular person like everybody else. Only divine persons are worshiped. Only God is worshiped. Any other form of worship is what the Bible calls idolatry. So he kneels down and he's worshiping Jesus. He's calling on God to come to him. And he's worshiping Christ. And he says to him, if you will, you can make me clean. And that's the Greek word, Thelo. If you will means Thelo. If you want to. Now here this dying leper sees Jesus and he knows he's divine. He knows he's the Moshiach, the Messiah. And he says to him, after worshiping him, I know you can make me well. I know that, but I'm not sure you want to. Okay, now here is an individual who has powerful rejection demons, who has been rejected by everyone because of his disease and his disability. And he is an outcast. And so the thoughts in his mind would naturally be, everybody else has rejected me. Everybody has turned away from me. I know you can help me. Other people could have helped me in some respect, but I know you can help me to the maximum level, but I'm not really sure you want to. And that's really true in the 21st century here in Christianity in America. Everybody knows that God can do things, but they're not sure he wants to do them. And here God answers the question. The $100,000 question has been answered, right? It's answered in this next verse. How do we know it's answered? Well, Jesus said, I don't do anything. I don't see my Father doing. I don't say anything. I don't hear my Father saying. So everything Jesus said and everything Jesus did, he had previously heard Father saying and doing. And so what's happening here is that Jehovah, the Hebrew God, Yahweh, Jehovah, is looking out through Jesus's eyes and he sees a dying leper staggering up to him and worshiping him. And then Father hears what the leper says and then says, I want to heal this leper. I like this guy. And Jesus says, moved with compassion, verse 41. Now this Greek word is quite remarkable, splanchnikomai. Splanchnikomai means to be able to feel the pain of someone else. Not like an empath. A lot of that stuff is demonic. But have you ever cared about somebody so much that when they were hurting, you were hurting? It usually happens at the highest level between a mother and a child. But you can love someone, a spouse or a child or a best friend, so much that when they're in pain, you feel their pain. You can feel it. It hurts. You have empathy and you have compassion for them. Splanchnizomai is a Greek word that means to hurt in the bowels, to hurt here in the stomach. Ow, my gut's hurting because you're hurting. It's sympathy on steroids. And Jesus is hurt by this man's pain. And he's moved with compassion. It says he lifted up his hand and he touched him. That's something you never do with leprosy because it's transmittable. And he said to him, here it is, Thelo, be clean. I want to. He heard Father say, I want to. And then Jesus said, Jesus says, I want to. And the Holy Ghost in that moment settled forever the question, does God want to help you? There's no debate about it anymore. There's no question about it anymore. You're in. You're in. If God likes a dying leper whom everybody else had rejected and who everybody else turned their back on, you're a slam dunk, friend. That's what you are, a slam dunk. Verse 42, and as soon as he had spoken it, see, he touched him first. He wasn't healed. The anointing transferred through the touch, and then he spoke it. And immediately the leprosy departed from him, and he was cleansed. He was cleansed. That's amazing, isn't it? Lots of revelations in only three verses. You know, the Bible is so rich, friend. It's difficult to describe, isn't it? It's so deep. It's kind of hard to believe at times. It's so great, it's hard to fathom at times. You know, this beautiful story about this dying leper in Mark chapter 1 was repeated in Matthew chapter 8. Do you remember that? Yeah. Here's what it says in Matthew chapter 8, verse 1. It says, when Jesus came down from the mountain, great multitudes. The Greek word for multitudes there is oklos. Oklos means a giant mob. They followed him. Jesus was, to use a slang term, a rock star in our terminology now. So-and-so is a rock star. That means that they have a huge, excited following. And behold, there came a leper and worshiped him, saying, Lord, if you will, you can make me clean. This is the same story, only told by a different apostle. Thelo again, if you want to, you can make me clean. And Jesus put forth his hand and he touched him and he said, Thelo, I want to be clean. And immediately his leprosy was cleansed. Verse 4 says, and Jesus said to him, see that you tell no man, but go your way and show yourself to the priest and offer the gift that Moses commanded you to offer as a testimony to them. See, the purpose of divine miracles and the reason God likes them so much and wants to heal you and wants to help you is because he wants you to testify to somebody else. Miracles are not to be kept to yourself. They are to be shared. They're to be shared. Jesus heard his father saying, I want that leper. I like that guy. Jesus saw his father reaching out his hand and touching him. So Jesus reached out and touched him. And then Jesus spoke out what father, he heard father saying, be clean. I want to help you be clean. The very next story here is, again, the same. Jesus went back to Capernaum, and as you know, Capernaum was Jesus' headquarters on the Sea of Galilee, and he had moved there from Nazareth, and that's where he lived. And it says a centurion hunted him down and came to him while he was at his home base in Capernaum. And again, he was doing the same thing. He was beseeching him, Paralikeo. He was begging him to come to my side, come with me, stand by my side. And he said to him, Lord, my servant is at home with the palsy. Paralyticus is a Greek word. It means to be suffering from a spinal cord injury. And it says that he is grievously basanizo, tormented. That means he's being tortured. Basanizo means to torture someone. this child, the centurion called him a servant. It's translated as servants in the King James Bible. Actually, the Greek word is pais. Pais means a child, you know, like somebody in junior high, something like that. A sixth grader, a seventh grader, eighth grader, something like that. So this was a kind of a grown-up child. And he says, Jesus immediately says to him, I will come and heal him. Now you notice there was no hesitation there. Do you notice Jesus heard his father say, yeah, let's go get that kid. Let's go heal him. Yeah. He heard Father say that. He could see Father heading toward the child. So Jesus said, I will come and heal him. No hesitation. No problemo. Then the centurion blows everybody's mind, including God's, when he says, Lord, I am not worthy that you should come under my roof, but speak the word only. And here it is. The logos is what I'm sharing with you today, is the word of God. Speak the word of God only, and my pais, my child, will be healed. How do I know this? Well, he says, I'm a man under authority, and I have soldiers under my authority. Somebody tells me to go here and go there, I go there. I tell them, go here and go there. They go there. They come here. I have authority. Somebody bosses me around, I boss these people around. That's how authority works. He was explaining to Jesus that, hey, I'm a person that understands authority. Somebody's in charge of me, I'm in charge of other people. I know exactly how it works. This person tells that one what to do. That one tells this one what to do. He's explaining authority to Jesus because he's saying to him, I understand your authority. Isn't that amazing? He said, I understand your authority. Okay, you're not a centurion. You're not in the military. But you have spiritual authority over the spirit world. And Jesus says, was marveled at the guy. That's the Greek word thamazo. It means to be in a state of shock, to be stunned. What? I don't believe I heard that. Jesus was amazed at this centurion because he wasn't even Jewish. He was in a way kind of like a proselyte, a Jewish convert. And the Bible in another story says that he had built a synagogue for the Jews. So he was definitely some kind of a follower of Jehovah and had great respect for Yahweh and knew about the Messiah. And so the centurion's thinking, hey, this guy, I've seen what this guy's doing. I hear about all these miracles. This matches up with the prophecies of Isaiah. This is the Messiah. This has got to be it. So the centurion had some familiarity with Judaism. And Jesus says to him, I say unto you, I have not found so great a faith anywhere in Israel. This guy had more faith and more understanding of the Moshiach, the Messiah, than the Jews did. Can you imagine that? You know, sometimes it's amazing, you know, in the mouth of babes and sucklings, sometimes things have come out that you would never come out of an adult's mouth. Here you have an amazing situation where a non-Jew knows more about Judaism than the Jews know about it. And Jesus said something profound after this. Quote, I say unto you that many shall come from the east and the west, and they will sit down with Abraham, Isaac and Jacob in the kingdom of heaven. Who are these people from the east and the west? Well, if you have a a mirror in your pocket there or in your purse, go ahead and pull it out and look in there. You are the one coming from the West, and some will come from the East. These are Gentiles. These are you. This is you. Okay? We're in the West, and so we're included in this. Many shall come from the West. That would be you and I. And from the East. And they will sit down with Abraham and Isaac and Jacob in the kingdom of heaven. But, he says, here's the but, and the but is a bummer. But the children of the kingdom shall be cast out into what? Outer darkness. The Greek word for darkness in that verse is skatas. It means shady. Skatas is a term to describe darkness and light when they're mixed together. You can kind of see a little bit, but you can't see clearly. It's shady. Have you ever met a born-again Christian who was shady? Yeah, not good. And in this outer shadiness where you can see, but you can't see clearly, there will be people doing what? Oh, man. Weeping and doing what? Brugmas, grinding their teeth. That's amazing. Here you have a teaching that seems on the surface of it very bizarre. In the spirit world, when you transition over there, it almost seems like from scripture that the spirit man, the inner man, looks like a spiritual replica of the physical man. The inner man looks like the physical man, but he's spiritual. And the natural man had teeth. The spirit man has teeth. The natural man kind of looks a certain way. The spirit man does too. This natural man has two arms and two legs. The spirit man, the same. The story of the rich man and Lazarus, again, highlights what this just says here. Then Jesus said to the centurion, go your way, and as you have believed, so be it done to you. And his child, Pais, was healed in the same hour. In the same hour. The child was miraculously, supernaturally healed from a distance. Jesus was nowhere near the child when he was healed, but the man's faith carried the supernatural power of the Holy Ghost from Jesus back to his house where he lived. And healed the child. And that is exactly how it works today, doesn't it? Yeah, it works great, doesn't it? And beautiful. The supernatural, miraculous power of God can be teleported or transported from one location to another based on how you believe. It says, as you have believed, so be it done to you, not to the kid, but to you. He was interceding for the child. God said, you're healed. What a great story. What a great story this one is. You can clearly see here how faith transports the supernatural power of the Holy Ghost to another location. This story was deliberately put in the New Testament by the Spirit of the Lord because the guy was a Gentile. In a way, it was kind of a prophetic story where you have God saying, hey, I'm not just reaching out to the Jews. I want everybody. And that's what God wants. He wants everybody. Of course, there's free will involved, obviously, and most people are not going to be saved, but that's unfortunate. But that's based on human free will. That day that Jesus healed the dying leper there in Mark and Matthew, as we just read, no other lepers got healed that day. Only one came up to him. That's unfortunate. Gosh, you know, if 100 of them had come up to him, you know what would have happened? He had 100 healed lepers. Because Jesus would have heard his father saying, I like 100 lepers. I want all the lepers healed. And Jesus then would have seen in his spirit, in his mind, he saw a father healing. He would have seen a father healing 100 lepers. But free will is the key. And only one leper came. Only one centurion came. How do we limit God's power? How do we stop it? How do we get rid of it? Well, we get rid of it through unbelief. We don't come because we don't believe. We don't obey because we don't believe. We don't listen because we don't believe. Imagine that. 100 lepers could have been healed, only one was. That's unfortunate. But we rejoice in the one, that's for sure. In my ministry, I see it all the time. We have a lot of people come to the Deliverance Center every week, in fact. You know, and they kind of sit in the back and they don't do anything. And during the altar call, the anointing falls at every service. It just falls right on top of the people. And demons are flying out of people, boom, 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 left and right. It happened last Friday. Happened last Thursday, happens every week. But there's always, you know, kind of a unit of people stuck in the back, you know, that don't come forward, don't do anything. All of them could be delivered, all of them could be healed, but they kind of hold back. They have doubts, they have unbelief, and they're struggling, right? 100 centurions could have come forward that day with, you know, somebody needed healing or someone needed deliverance. Didn't matter. The Holy Ghost doesn't have any limitations except the ones we put on him. We put limitations on God and have to suffer the result of it. And it's painful. It's hurtful. Jesus said, as you have believed, so be it unto you. Go your way as you have believed. Okay? And here we get to the crossroads of life. Whew, there it is. There's a T in the road. If you go to the right, you'll see disciples over there. And if you go to the left, where most of the Christians are, say 99% of them, 98%, to the left is Christians, right? To the right are disciples. All disciples on the right of the road are Christians. Almost no Christians are disciples. The difference between a Christian and a disciple is disciples don't take no from the devil as an answer. They don't take no for an answer. They're not going to do it. Sorry, it's not going to happen. Christians will take no for an answer. Oh, not so well. It didn't work out. Maybe I could pray for something else, and hopefully, and maybe that will be. No, that's not going to happen either. You're just a Christian. You're not a disciple. Most of your prayers are not going to get answered. Did you know that most prayers from Christians don't get answered? Did you know that? Yeah, almost all prayers from disciples get answered. A Methodist is a disciple, and a Christian is a Christianos. Christianos is a follower of Christ or a believer in Christ. A disciple is a learner of Christ. Methodist, a learner of Christ. The disciples are different than Christians, completely different. Disciples won't take no for an answer. The devil takes a dump on them. They don't put up with it. They're not going to take it. Disciples are not ruled by fear, anxiety, cowardice, shyness, weakness, introversion. Nope, they overcame that. They are very similar to the great British evangelist Smith Wigglesworth. He said, I am not moved by how I feel, and I'm not moved by what I see. I am only moved by what I believe. And that's how Wigglesworth lived his life, wasn't it? Yeah, it's beautiful. Did you read the Wigglesworth books? I got all of them. Yeah, they're fabulous. But what was Wigglesworth doing? Well, he was doing exactly what the centurion was. A disciple knows that God wants to heal and deliver. A Christian isn't sure, like the leper. You've got the leper kind of symbolizing a Christian, and you've got the centurion symbolizing a disciple. There's a difference. There's a big difference. There's a real difference. A disciple has already worked through all the failures that a Christian is currently experiencing. Most Christians are spiritual losers because they have no patience and no perseverance. They cannot persevere. When once facing adversity, once somebody doesn't like them, once somebody disagrees with them, they bag it. They head home. They come to God in prayer like the leper, but they're not sure God wants to help them. After all, the people at church told them, God doesn't heal everybody, and you know, healing went out with the apostles, and they've got all kinds of weird excuses and strange things to cover up their unbelief and their doubt. Disciples don't do that. They've worked through that months or years ago. They don't believe that anymore. They know that Jesus looks on people with compassion. They know he wants to heal them. They know he likes people, wants to heal them. Yeah, he does. He actually likes people. John 17. He loves people. John 16. Those two Greek words, as you know, are different. Philia is someone you like. Agape is someone you love. Both those terms are used of your Heavenly Father in those two chapters, 16 and 17. Really fantastic material. That's the heart of the Bible right there, isn't it? Yeah, 15, 16, 17 of John. That's kind of the bullseye of God's word. Boom. Those three chapters, there's so many divine revelations in those three chapters. It's kind of hard to believe. Shocking. It's great beyond description. I may do that on my next podcast. You never know. You've got to transition out of being a Christian to being a disciple. Disciples already have their doubts and unbelief and questions answered. They don't take no for an answer. Doesn't matter what the devil tells him. He's always going to tell you no. He says no all the time. Everything is a no to him. Christians buy it. They go, oh, nuts. I'm kind of discouraged. I'll go home. Think I'll go take a nap. Disciples don't take naps. Disciples go around looking for a fight. Christians are trying to avoid them. Yeah, a disciple is a professional. Christians are amateurs. They have enough of God's word to be dangerous and be involved in all kinds of false doctrines, but they don't have enough of God's word to actually move with the power of the Holy Ghost. When you need a miracle from God, you got to find a disciple. You can't find a bunch of Christians. You're going to get nowhere. If you don't believe me, if you have a disabled child, a disabled relative, a disabled spouse, someone you love, someone you care about, call up a church prayer chain and put their name on it. I mean, almost nothing happens, almost all the time, nothing happens. You only need one disciple and the whole thing turns. You got a leper who's a Christian. You got the centurion who's a disciple. The centurion knew about the power of God and God's desire to heal. You don't need to come to my house. Just speak it here, right here. Just say it right here. And my child's healed. Pace. He gets up. He's no longer being tortured. Basanidza. He's well. Just don't come over my place. Just speak it right here. We're good. I'm good. That's a disciple. A leper who was a Christian says, Lord, I know you can hear me, but man, I'm just not sure. I've been debating it back and forth in my mind. I don't know. I'm curious about this and that. I got some questions about this and that. That's a Christian. Say, Christians don't reach out to people. They don't care. They don't do anything simply because they do not believe. Why? Jesus said to the disciple, centurion, as you have believed, so be it unto you. As you have believed. See that? Christians think prayers are answered in a certain way. Well, I've got to get to this person, this preacher. I need them to see me. I need them to put their hands on me. I need this. I need that. I need to outline it this way. Here's how it's done. I need a format. I need some principles. I need some path to follow. I need some instructions, X, Y, Z, A, B, C. Stop. Disciples don't do that kind of thing, friend. They don't do that. They take whatever the devil gives them and then just smash and beat it out. Yeah. You know, you look at Roman Catholicism, I feel so sorry for them. You know, the whole system is based on religions and rituals and religiosity and wearing certain clothes, eating certain foods, smelling a certain way, wearing a cone head, different things, reciting certain prayers, reciting out of a book, reciting out of prayer manual. Drives you nuts. That's a Christian. That's somebody who thinks, oh, it works this way. I got a formula here. Disciples don't have formulas. They don't have rituals. They don't have any of those things. They just, look, you don't need to come to my house. You don't need to lay your hands on him. We don't have to strike up the band while you're coming up the walk. That doesn't need to happen. Just speak the word here, and my child will be healed there. And Jesus said, yeah, that sounds good to me. I just heard Father say that. Uh-huh. As you have believed, so be it unto you. Go your way. Go your way. Yeah, that's how it works. And in 2023, you know what you're going to do? You're going to transition out of Christianity into discipleship. You're going to become a disciple of God. You're going to get rid of all this riffraff in your family, your house, your mind. You're going to become a carrier of God's word. Whoa, bang. You're going to become a very dangerous person in 2023. You're going to be like the centurion. You're going to be a winner. You're going to transition out of the majority and go to the minority. Have you ever noticed throughout all of Scripture, it was always the minority that represented God? Do you happen to notice that? Yeah. It's always the minority that represented God. It was never the majority. There was a minority there when Jesus died. Everybody had abandoned him. You got rejection demons? Listen, the Lord Jesus, I mean, he's there. He knows exactly what it feels like to be rejected. I mean, think about it. He was ministering for 3 to 4 years in Israel. He must have had a few hundred thousand people healed. Can't do it. Right? He must have had thousands of deliverances. I mean, he taught the word of God, you know, like nobody had ever seen it before. It was unbelievable. Shocking, actually. And when he died, almost nobody was there. His mother was there. His best friend, John, was there. And the women were standing afar off. So there was a collection of women. Doesn't say how many. And nobody else was there. Everybody had bagged him. Everybody. And left him. Yeah, he was despised and rejected of men. A man of sorrows, acquainted with grief, the great prophet Isaiah said. So no matter what you're going through and no matter what kind of pain you're involved in, he understands because he got rejected far more than you and I ever will. 2023 is not your year to be rejected. It is your year to transition into a centurion. That's what you're going to do. And I tell you what, it's going to be fantastic. And you're going to send me your testimony to mike@hardcorechristianity.com. Huge things are going to happen in your life in 2023. It has to. We're running out of time here. The rapture is only a few years away now. I can't prove this scripturally, but I really believe it. I think the false prophet and the Antichrist are alive somewhere on the earth right now. They're probably in junior high, something like that. And I think this thing's going down in a few years. I never dreamed that at my age, you know, I'm an old person, that I would ever see the rapture. I really never believed it. But in 2020, when I saw Satan take over the United States and how quick it happened, how fast he did it, I changed my mind. I've changed my mind. I think I may hit the rapture, even at my age. I think the false prophet is alive somewhere on the earth right now. He's the most dangerous human being spiritually that ever lived. Greater even than Nimrod 3,500 years ago, 4,000 years ago, even greater than him. This guy is the most fearsome spiritual warlock that ever walked the planet. I think he's alive somewhere. I think he's in junior high or something. I think this thing's got a short fuse. And because of that, you are on a short fuse on your trek to becoming a centurion. That's what you're going to do. And then you're going to send me an email.